I like myself the way I am at 52. Sorry, I forgot the question. Fightingly at 50 and forgetful. I'm 50 and I'm going to give up. I still love my red lipstick. I still like my hair colored just the way I want it. I feel on top of the world. So I'm not going to give up on that yet.
If you think age can pull down your spirits, then this lady is here to prove you wrong. The beautiful and celebrated author of 5 non-fiction books, Sudha Menon, chronicles her experiences in the most savage way in her latest publish, Feisty at 50. The 52-year-old author, journalist, and a writing coach wears a red lipstick like a boss, and with her charismatic smile, throws away the stereotypes and tells the world how to live a full and indeed a feisty life regardless of age. HappyAging met Sudha Menon in her beautiful house and talked about age, health and more. Let's hear from her.
Actually, just my own life. You know, I used to think that anybody over the age of 25 is very, very old. But that was when I was 18. Now that I'm, 52, I think 52 is like so young. And what inspired me really to do this book was that as I turned into my late 40s, I realized that my life was becoming a veritable circus. You know, I'm searching for my chasma, I'm losing things all the time, I'm losing my mind, I have all these lines on my face, my hair is going, gray, hot flushes, and all of this madness was happening, and often I would find myself in the blue funk. And it went on till one day I just sat myself down and I said that this is enough and no more of this. And if this were like happening to somebody else, it would be so funny. And so I said, I'm going to look at this with my funny hat on and make a book out of this, and I have the most fun writing it. And that's how I wrote Feisty at 50. Oh, a lot of it. You know, I think we are one of the most ageist societies in the whole world. I'm sure there's a lot of ageism in other parts of the world, but I feel it so much now. You know, these messages that come to you that as you enter your 40s, you get these messages that you're 40 now, and it's well meant advice, of course. But people say, why do you bother coloring your hair? Just let it be, you know. And why are you so bothered about how you look? Or why do you want to wear this kind of a thing? And these are all friends and relatives who so unthinkingly put you down. And I would always say that, no, I'm not ready to retire. No, I'm not ready to give up on life. I don't think this is I don't think this is age inappropriate. I think I would like to wear this dress. And all of this went on. And I think at some point we have to say no. You do the things that you think is right for you, and let nobody else tell you what is, age appropriate for you. I think so. I think, a lot of us, especially women tend to, I think this is from years of conditioning, that women just give up on themselves as they age, as they enter their 50s. Most of them are told that this is the time for you to slow down, to give up on your careers, to look after your grandchildren, just rest and be at home and be, take the spiritual route and all of that. And to some extent, I think we have conditioned ourselves to accept all of it. I'm not really ready to give up and say that, I'm 50 and I'm going to give up. I still love my red lipstick. I still like my hair colored just the way I want it. I like to paint my nails red. And I like all of this. And funnily enough for me, when I was in my 30s and my early 40s, none of these things actually mattered. It is now that it begins to matter. And I feel on top of the world. So I'm not going to give up on that yet. I manage my health by walking 5 days or 6 days a week. I don't think I'm very fit because I also tend to eat a lot of dessert, which is good for my soul, not good for my body. But basically, I think a fair bit of awareness in recent times about how I should look after my health. My mother has diabetes, and so I'm very aware that I could, you know, be possibly next in line. And so I take care of my health. I try and de-stress by doing things that I really like doing, you know. Wandering around town when I get bored, you know, poking around in the shops, meeting my friends, going for a movie, meeting for a meal a couple of times a month with some friends or family. That's how I sort of be emotionally, mentally and physically fit. It's not dull, it's slow. And slow and steady wins the race, isn't it? So no, but I don't think sex after 50, the thing about this is, I think we don't talk about, we pretend that all the children came from immaculate conception. We, you know, even now at age 52, I find it difficult to believe that my mother and father had sex. And that is really ridiculous, isn't it? We all have sex. Sometimes I read the agony aunt columns, the sex agony aunt columns in newspapers, and I find it. I don't know what to say. Sometimes I'm awed, sometimes I'm embarrassed. But there are people who are 70 and 80 who have questions about why their sex life is slowing down. And if I, with so much learning and so much education, can think that that is ridiculous, then there's something wrong with it, isn't it? So no, sex after 50 is not dull. I think it comes with a lot more stuff. You know, there is so much of caring and so much of loving there. You know, it's just not the hormones. It's about a relationship that has lasted a long while. I think exactly that. You know, relationships mature by then. It's not the relationship that is led by hormones, not the relationships led by the romantic stuff that you're reading. After 50s, by the time you've been together a really long time, in your 50s, if you've been with the same man, that's a long, long time to be with a person. And I think that relationship is built on trust, it is built on shared experiences, and maybe raising children together, setting a home up together. So I think it's a wonderful, wonderful time. Yeah, I'm told that 50s are the new 30s. I don't want to be 30 again. I'm so happy being 50 because at 30 I was not a nice person. I was too full of myself. I was in a hurry to prove myself in a career. I was a woman in a hurry because I had so many things to accomplish. I like myself the way I am at 52. Oh, I think that is the most special relationship in my life now, my relationship with my mother. And as I turned 50 and as I turned 52 recently, I think I understand her much, much better now. You know, even thinking of her now makes me want to weep sometimes, because when she was 40, I had my only baby. So she raised that baby. When she was 41, my sister had her baby, then she looked after that child. And this went on till her entire life. After the time she was 40, she spent looking after grandchildren and her own children. And I'm sure, you know, I at 52 am willing to do that, raise several grandchildren and selflessly devote my life to that. So I think I understand my mother much, much better now, and it's a very happy place to be in. My mom stays with my younger sister. She used to live with my father next door, and when my father passed away 3 years ago, she moved into my sister's house. But the thing is, my sister is a working woman. Her husband is also working. She has a teenager daughter who's in school all day. So Amma, if she has to travel, she needs an Uber or something. And so pretty much every afternoon when my sister is not around, she'll call me and say, can you book me an Uber? And then I do that. If I'm not also available, then she will call my husband or she'll call my daughter, and one of us kind of take care of her transportation needs. It is long-winded, but we still make it happen for her. if my sister's away for a long time, say for 3 or 4 days or 5 days, then typically either I'll go to Bombay and be with her, or then she will come to Pune and be with me for 4 days. She doesn't have the confidence to stay alone at night, you know, at home. The rest of the day she's very, very independent. So when my father was 83 years ago, when my father turned 83, he took ill suddenly, and within a matter of just 5 weeks, he was gone. And it left my mother completely devastated. She was 16 years younger to him and had always been his companion from the time she was 16. And so she went into this deep depression, and we really started getting worried about, you know, what is going to happen to her. And then she came visiting me one day, and that was the day I was supposed to take, the next day I was supposed to take one of my writing workshops, Get Writing. That's where I teach people how to write. And so I was preparing for that, and my mother said, you know, do you think I can write? And I said, of course you can write. And she said, will you teach me also how to write? And I said, yes, from tomorrow I'll teach you every day to write. And then for the next 2 weeks when she was here with me, every morning I would sit with her and take her through all of those processes that I used to do in my Get Writing workshop. And my mom took to it like, you know, fish to water. And in a matter of 6 months, she was ready with a book about her life with my father. From the time she was 16 to the time he passed away at 83. And I think writing that book was so hugely therapeutic for her, because she relived all the good days with him. She, as she spoke about her relationship with my father, I think when she spoke about that to me, that also worked as therapy. When she started writing all of that, it was like venting. She resolved a lot of the stuff that she had, you know, a lot of issues that she had in her mind. All those conflicts got resolved. And I think my mother is now in a place where she has accepted that he's gone. And every time she feels a little sad or, you know, unhappy or lonely, she takes that book up and she reads through it, and then she starts laughing again. So, healthcare for seniors in India, and I'm told that I will now fit into that because I'm already 50 plus. But what I find really, really inexcusable is this thing when an elderly person goes to a doctor and says that this is paining or that is paining, or I feel this or I feel that. The first question they say is, age ke hisab se ye sab hona hi hai na? No, this is to do with aging. It'll happen. Forget it. You know, ignore it. I don't think that's right. I think you have to explain things to somebody in a better manner. Have a little more compassion. Have a little more empathy. And I think this is very much India. You know, I find myself telling my mother often that, Mom, this is with age. You know, your aches and pains will be there. Just accept it. But when I have the same ache and pain, I'm not willing to accept it. I'll whine and moan about it for the rest of my life. So I think elderly care in India is elder care in India is not enough. It's not enough to build specifically residential colonies for them. It is not just enough to do that. It's not just enough to relegate them to the fringes of our society and forget about them. I think we all have to develop a little more compassion and find solutions to fighting their loneliness, to finding ways to how you can make them part of our mainstream life, and not just give them their medicines on time, take them to their doctor on time, and then just forget about them. I think that's not enough. I think happy aging is probably a time in life when you have resolved all the conflicts that you have had in your younger age. All the self-doubt has gone out of the window. There is more confidence about the way you are, the choices you are making. Your place in life is a happy place. You are confident, you are secure in your home, you are secure in your relationships. And you are actually looking forward to life much more than you were in your frantic 40s.